Well, we're continuing in our study of the Sermon on the Mount, and this morning we're again looking at the Lord's Prayer. I think it's very fitting that as, I didn't plan it this way really, but it's fitting that we're studying prayer. And the Lord's Prayer is all about Jesus teaching us how to pray. So even if we wonder, how do I pray for an hour? That's what the Lord's Prayer teaches us to do. If you have your Bibles, we'd invite you to open to Matthew chapter 6. If you don't, there's one in front of you. It's on page 811. And we're going to really be looking at verse 10 especially today. What does it mean to pray, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven? Let me begin my time now with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you so much for the chance that we have to come together and, Father, to be able to dive into your word. I thank you for the principles that are here. Father, I thank you for the things that you're teaching me. I pray now that you get me out of the way and, Father, that your spirit speak through me and in spite of me. Father, help us to hear what you have for us this morning. Father, I pray your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this is all about Jesus teaching us how to pray. And I want to tell you from the onset, that says a couple things. Number one, we need to learn how to pray. You know, we think it's just talking to God. It should come naturally to us. But the fact of the matter, it doesn't. And Jesus teaches us because it's something that we know. And if you're like me, that's comforting. That's reassuring. Because although we don't like to admit it, most of us really struggle with praying, especially praying in front of other people or going to pray for an hour. And in fact, a lot of times what we do is that we try to fake it. We try to think, how does it sound spiritual? How do we say the right words? In fact, just to begin, you know, I found one of my favorite little clips of a comedian, a guy named Michael Jr., talks about this, about how we can sometimes, you know, feel the pressure to fake it, to look right, to be able to say the right kind of prayers. Watch this. I think you can relate to it.
I remember going to church as an adult, right, for the first time when I started going to church, and I would walk in, and the pastor was like, he said, I want you to pray with your neighbor. And I'm like, well, my neighbor don't go to this church. I don't know if you want me to... You want me to call my neighbor on the phone? That's creepy. I ain't gonna do that. Right? Then they explained to me, right, your neighbor is a person sitting next to you. Listen, I'm brand new at this Christian stuff. I didn't even know you're supposed to pray out loud, let alone with this lady. I don't even know this lady. What am I supposed to pray about? Lord, help these bumps go down on this lady's face. I don't know what to pray about. I don't know what I'm supposed to pray about, right? She went first. She was praying all good, and she must have been John the Baptist's little sister or something. Praying. She was like, Dear Heavenly Father, you said in your word in the 6th chapter, the third verse of the book of Matthew, the 601st word on page 1248. Lord, you said, but seek, S is in search, E is in everywhere, E is in excellent, K is in kingdom. You're the Alpha, Nisi, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha. I'm thinking, man, she even know his nicknames. Now, it's my turn to pray, right? But I don't got the spiritual vocabulary to just, but I'm not going to let her outpray me. So I'm like, okay, God, first of all, you are good people. You know, you are good, Lord. You are good. You are good to the last drop, Lord. Because, Lord, I just got to obey my thirst, Lord. You know, because choosy moms choose Jesus. So, Lord, because... You know, as the rocket's red glare, Lord, it gave proof to the night, Lord. I believe I could fly, amen.
Now, I love that because we can relate to it. We feel that pressure. Well, that's not what Jesus wants us to do. He gives us the Lord's Prayer, and it's not something we're to memorize and recite. What he gives it to us is an outline of the principles, of the ideas that he wants us to pray. And one of the things that I've been surprised to learn as I've studied this more is it's not just that he's giving us ideas, but there's a cumulative nature to the ideas. There's a cumulative nature to prayer. It's not just he's saying, well, pray this and pray this and pray this, and here's all these different parts. But literally what Jesus is teaching us is that they all grow together. There's a sense that what we pray in the beginning builds on what we pray later, that they're related. And I really won't be able to understand what's in the middle of the prayer. I won't understand what it means to petition, to confess, all these things here, unless I first of all build on the ideas that he's telling us in the beginning. And that's something that, again, the more I've learned, the more I've understood, I've been surprised how much I've seen this. You know, that in the past I thought that, you know, here's God, all these ideas, and as long as I have these ideas, they aren't necessarily related, but they are. In a sense, it's almost like, you know, as they build on each other, it's almost the, here you have the foundation of our Father. That's the basis. And you know, I can't reach what's next until I stand on that. And I step on that, the shelf, and I go to the next part that he calls us to, our Father in heaven. And when I step up on that, then I can reach the next shelf, and I can come, hallowed be your name, and I understand what that means. But it's not until I do that that I can get to the next shelf, and I can say, okay, now God, your kingdom come, your will be done. And each part builds on each other in that way. But I've got to, in a sense, to step on the foundation and the next step before I can reach the furthest thing up. In fact, what we're going to see is when it talks about what does it mean to pray, your kingdom come, your will be done. It's not only that it's a proper foundation, but it not only builds on hallowed be your name, it literally is a continuation. And see, last week we talked about this a little bit. We talked about what does it mean to pray, God, hallowed be your name. And what we saw is when we looked at that, it's celebrating God for who he is. It's knowing God for who he is. But beyond that, it's saying, God, I want to make you the thing of ultimate importance and value in my life. I want to make you central. Now, to understand that, we have to understand that if I pray, God, hallowed be your name. God, I pray that you would be central in my life, that you would be the defining truth in my life. It's only natural for us to say, God, I want you to be central. And because I want you to be central, I want your kingdom to be central. I want your will to be central. See, the principle is this. When we embrace God as the center of our life, it means that we will also embrace his kingdom. We will also embrace his will. See, if God is the most important thing in my life, it's only logical that I'm going to come to him and say, God, now what's most important to you? Because I want to make what's most important to you important to me. Unfortunately, that's not the way that I often pray. Unfortunately, I can come out and I can say the words, God, hallowed be your name. I can speak words of prayer. And then as soon as I'm done with that, I'm saying in a sense, God, I want you to be the center of my life. But now that I've not acknowledged that, now let's spend all the time talking about my thoughts, my concerns, the things that are important to me. God, I want you to be assured that you're aware of my desires, that you're concerned about my agenda. You see, the goal of my prayer is to make sure that, God, you're focused on me. You see, I have my things that I want to build. In a sense, it's my will, my kingdom. And God, I want it to be all about me. No, if I realize that God is central, then before I spend all my time trying to tell God to get to know my kingdom, my desires, so that God is focused on me, I've got to come and say, God, you're the center of my life, and I want to spend some time focused on you. I want to spend time realizing that it shouldn't be all about me, that I don't want to be the center. I want to recognize that I focus on you. Now, part of that says, well, wait a second, does that mean that what we need is unimportant? No, it's actually the opposite. What happens is when we focus on God as central, when we recognize that, we're going to realize that when we let go of what we come thinking we need, we're going to find in God things that we really need. That's what Jesus talks about in Matthew chapter 16. Whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. If we come and God, it's all about me, see, we're gonna lose it. We're not gonna find the things that we desire. But if we say, God, I'm willing to let go because I want your kingdom, I want you to be the center, then we'll find it. Or Matthew 6, we're going to see in a couple weeks, Matthew 6:33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. What's he saying? Is that if we don't make it about our kingdom, but his kingdom, if we seek that first, if we make that central in our lives, then we're going to discover all the things that we really need. But you know why we do this? Why we struggle with it is because we don't really believe those things. We fear. We fear whether God is really good. We fear that whether he's really a loving father. We fear the things that are the foundation of prayer. You know, we fear, God, if I really surrender my kingdom and my desires, if I surrender my will to you, I'm not sure where you're going to take me. God, if I give you the right to take things from me, I'm not sure. You might take me down a path of misery. You might send me to be a missionary in Africa. You might send me to, you know, take away the things that I really desire. See, what we're fearing is we're saying, God, I don't think that you're good. And if I let you have my deepest dreams, I think you're going to take something away. Or sometimes I'll talk to people and they know that they're living in a lifestyle that's against God's will and God's calling them to give it up. And I know that God's calling me to do that, but we say, I can't do that because I don't trust God. You see, if I give this up, if I walk away from what I know that God wants me to walk away from, life is going to be miserable. Because at our core, we're saying, I don't trust God. And what we have to realize is that when we build on this, we will always trust and seek the kingdom if we trust the King. And if we don't trust the King, if we don't trust the Father, then we won't desire his kingdom. It will be about what we want. But we struggle with that. But what does it then mean if we trust the King? What does it mean then to come and really pray for his kingdom to come? Again, to not just say these words. For starters, as it kind of is laid out here, if we pray his kingdom come, it means that we have to start by submitting to the King. I mean, it's simply this. When we pray your kingdom come, it's asking God to say, God, I want your kingdom to come in my life. I want to allow you to be the King in my life. I want to let you be sovereign and have the right of rule in who I am. The simple truth is this. You know, God's kingdom reigns wherever he's king. His being the king and the kingdom are inseparable. And I can't pray, God, your kingdom come, but I don't want you to be king in my life. God, I want your kingdom to come, but you know, this part of life, you know, it's off, you know, I'm not going to give you control. The fact of the matter is, we cannot pray your kingdom come until we first of all come and say, God, I give you the right of lordship. I give you the right of king in my life. I give you the right to have rule over every part of us. Now, you know what? That's hard for us. It's hard for us, especially as Americans. I think one of the reasons it's hard is that we are people that live in a democracy. And in democracy, the concept of a king with total power and authority over us is foreign. You see, in democracy, we have leaders that we elect, and they have to listen to us. And we expect them to lead in a way that is consistent with our desires. And if they don't, we vote them out. We reject them. We reject their authority. See, but that's not the way that a king works. A king has complete authority over his subjects. And the kingdom of God is not a democracy. He doesn't ask for input. He doesn't ask for a vote. He doesn't ask what we like. You see, but that's totally different than the way that we're exposed. We're used to, God, you want me to do that? Well, I'm not going to give you the right there. No, if I submit to his kingdom, it means that I submit in every aspect. That I don't consult him. I don't try to, you know, work it out with him. You know, I think what we often do more than that is that, you remember, sometimes you see bumper stickers or license plates, you know, they have these, God is my co-pilot. And I think that's what we often think. You know, we don't want a king, we want a co-pilot. We don't even want a pilot, we want somebody next to us that we consult and we say, what do you think about here? And if we agree with you, then I'll go your direction. Now, I don't have a God as my co-pilot's bumper sticker on my car. Part of the reason is that I'm afraid I'll get in a wreck and then we'll say, what did God do? You know, I don't want to blame God for my stupidness. But the thing is, it's not that God should be our co-pilot. It's not our advisor. He's our pilot. He's our king. It's not a democracy. Do we want an advisor? Do we want a co-pilot? Or are we willing to say, your kingdom come, God, I give you the right of rule of authority in my life? Now, and I will acknowledge, when we do that, it takes your whole life to figure out what that means. It's not a one-time surrender because God says, okay, well, you surrender. Okay, well, now you're willing to surrender that. And, oh, no, no. Yeah. And God is patiently allows us to work and to surrender one thing and after another. But the fact is, are we willing to say, God, I give you the right to be king? There's one more aspect of kingship that I want to just briefly touch on, and that is when we understand what it means to pray your kingdom come, it means that we understand that it's not only in our own life, but in our culture. And as he's going to bring in our culture, we're a part of answering that prayer. We're willing to see how God will use us to answer that prayer. What does it mean for his kingdom to come on earth as it is in heaven? It means that God takes his authority, his power, his rule, and he starts to realize it here in this earth. And how do we have that kingdom? He calls us to be part of it, not as warriors who conquer, but as witnesses who share the good news of the gospel. And victory is come as we share the good news of the gospel one person at a time, as lives are changed. And we have to ask, if I'm praying for God's kingdom, do I really want it? And if I really want it, am I willing to let God use me as an instrument of that? And the fact of the matter is that every person here, you have a chance to interact. You interact with people I could never reach. You have people in your life that would never listen to me, but God has put you in their life because he wants you to be a vehicle to share the good news. He wants to expand the kingdom. And if we pray that prayer, then we have to say, okay, God, use me to be a part of it. Are you willing to do that? But he calls us to pray, your kingdom come, but then also your will be done on earth as it in heaven. What does that mean? What does it mean for God's will to be done? Now, there's a lot of confusion about this. This is one of the things that even as I read about different, you know, have different ideas, and there's a lot of confusion about praying for God's will. I mean, some people will often use it as a postscript to the end of the prayer. You know, so we'll pray, God, I pray that I'll get this new job, if it's your will. You know, God, I pray that, you know, keep me and my family healthy, if it's your will. God, I pray that I might win the lottery. Never hurts to ask, you know, if it's your will. You know, it's just, so we just sit there and we pray whatever we want. But that's not what it's saying. It's something of surrender. I think it's easy to use this in a flippant manner. Let me share a story. Give a good example. There was a Christian who was struggling with weight loss, and he decided that he was going to diet. He realized that every part of his problem, every morning he'd drive past this bakery, and he would get a cup of coffee and a big box of donuts, and so he was going to, as part of that, he's going to change his way to the bakery, you know, driving to work. And so he went on a diet, he changed his way to drive, he lost 6 pounds in the course of the first couple weeks. But in the middle of the second week, you know, his plan went up in smoke. He came into work, and his colleagues were amazed. He brought this big, you know, box of donuts in, and he had shared what they were doing. I said, I thought you were on a diet. He says, well, it's God's will for me to eat these donuts. And they're like, what in the world are you saying? He says, well, you know, by mistake this morning, I was driving to work, and I went my old route. And it was just by my mistake. And when I saw what I did, I started to pray, and I started to feel like maybe God was saying, you've done so well, I want to give you a reward. And so I said, God, is this what your will is for me? So I said, God, you know, if you want me to have this reward, then let me just, as I drive by, find an open spot in front of the bakery, and I'll stop there, and I'll let you know that's your affirmation. And wouldn't you know it, the sixth time around the block, I found an open spot. Now, we often might think that's what it is, you know, it's God's will, and that's how we use it. But it's actually something deeper. It actually deals with the whole purpose of what prayer is. So when you think about the purpose of prayer, what we've talked about is that the whole purpose of prayer is something that about relationship. We've talked about that. But when we think about prayer, we often think of it as sharing our needs, sharing our desires, sharing our will. In fact, that's evidenced by the fact of how we pray. I mean, there are many of us, if we were to say, how's your prayer life? Most of us, I usually don't pray very much. I pray very little. You know, maybe before meals and maybe the, you know, one time the week of prayer. And most of us don't pray that often until something happens in our life, right? You know, and then we have a crisis. Somebody gets sick, we lose a job, something, we have this crisis and suddenly we're praying and we're getting everybody to pray and we've got these prayer chains. And here we are, go through this, all this time of prayer. Now, if that's true, then we have to say, why does that change? Suddenly we have this need of God, we have this incredible need, and suddenly we pray all the time. And we expect him to answer. And we what we're doing with our actions, in a sense, we would never say this in our words or theology, but we're saying basically, you know, God, you exist to meet my needs. The whole purpose of prayer is for me to come and tell you my needs, and you exist for that purpose. And so when I don't have a perceived need, you know, then I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time. But when I've got a perceived need, then I'm going to come and I'm going to expect you to listen. I'm going to expect you to answer. And if you don't answer, well, then I'm just not going to trust you again. And I've met numerous people that are in this church who struggle trusting God because you had a need and you came to God and you poured out your heart and you said, God, heal this person, do this, save this marriage, do whatever. And God didn't do it. And you're like, well, how can I trust him again? You see, at our core of our being, we would never say these words, but we treat God in a way that he's defined by what he does for us. That's what we think of prayer often being. But look at how Jesus teaches us to pray. Again, remembering that we're to build on these principles. Does he say, it's all about you, it's all about your needs? No, look, what does he say? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done. It's all about him. The emphasis is on not on the person praying, not on our needs, but on the person being prayed to. And what he's telling us this is that when we come, we are focused on our needs. That's what we see. And what we do is we come to God and we think that somehow it's transactional, that God, what can we do? How do we meet our needs? You know, what do you want? And God, you know, what I need from you is this. And God, your value to me is only defined by the degree that you meet my need. And Jesus is saying, no, our focus is not to be on that. I want you to realize when that is our focus, what is happening is our needs literally are becoming our gods. What we are most focused on, what we love the most, what we treasure the most is our need. That's our God. And God is, we're coming to him as a means to meet that need. And he says, no, I want you to realize that what we need more than anything else is that we need God. We need to come before him. We need to recognize that, God, I want you to be central. I want your kingdom. I want your will to be central. Well, what about our needs? Well, we're going to see next week. He teaches us to pray. Give us this day our daily bread. We're called to bring our needs. But before we bring our needs, he wants us to come and say before God, here's my will, here's my need. Before I get there, God, I want to make sure I ask, what is your will? What do you want? God, I know these are the things that I know I need. God, these are the things I'm overwhelmed with. But before I get there, I want to stop and say, God, I realize that you know better than I do. It's a prayer of surrender. You see, literally, it is redefining our approach to prayer. Because when we think of prayer, we often think of, is a request, our wall prayer. It's got all kinds of requests there. We should go and pray for that. That's part of prayer. But it's not the center. And it's not the basis. All of that is built upon the foundation of things that are more core and more central. Again, remember, the primary purpose of prayer is relationship. God invites us to come to him on the basis of our Father. In relationship, he wants to know us. And all of it is building on the theology of understanding his Father. He wants to know us. It's a relationship through what Jesus has done for us, not through what we earn. He's Father in heaven who knows better than we are. We hallow his name. We reflect upon who he is. And then when he says, when you pray, kingdom come and will be done, take all that theology and apply it to your life. If you believe that, now let that define our prayers. Because we come and we say, God, you are my Father. And because you are my Father, I know you and I trust you. You love me. You've shown that. You're my Father in heaven who knows better than I am. And Father, I hallow your name because you're central and I desire your kingdom. I desire your will as it is in heaven, here on earth. And because of that, you see suddenly now praying, your will be done. It isn't a command. It's the natural expression of believing all the things that he's taught us to pray so far. It changes the way that we see prayer. Because if we understand this, we understand it's relationship, but it's a relationship that transforms us. The subject is God. It's the relationship. The object of prayer is a transformation. See, now, we've got to even understand, how does this work out? Well, we think, well, it's getting things from God. It's answering prayer. No, we've got to understand that give us this day our daily bread is built on your will be done. See, when we think about our needs and our desires before we go to God and tell him what we want, then what we're saying is, in a sense, saying, God, here's my will, here's my thoughts, here's my ideas, and God, I'm trying to get you to change your mind. But if I pray, God, your will be done. God, you know better than I do. You love me better than I do. Your will be done. What we're doing is saying, God, now here's my heart, but I give you the right to change me. God, God invites us to openly come and express our needs. We're going to see again that next week. He wants us to pour out our every thought, our every desire before him. But it's not to inform him. It's not to somehow talk him into it. It's not to somehow say, you know, you're right, I never thought of it that way before. The purpose of prayer is not to somehow inform God or to change God. The purpose of prayer is to get to know God and then to share our heart. And as we share our heart and our desires and our needs, to expose it before God, to give him the right to change us. To come and say, God, here's my heart. Here's what I long for the most. But because I trust that you know me better than I do, that you have a plan that's bigger than mine, before I get to my wishes and my desires and I want to tell you about how they need to be here, God, I give you the right to change me. Because before I get to my agenda, I want to know your agenda. Your agenda for my family becomes before my agenda. Your agenda for my friendships, for my dating, for my relationship come before my agenda. Your agenda for my money, your agenda for my career, your agenda for my kids' future, all these things come before me. So before I dump my worries and my plans and try to tell you what you want, God, I'm gonna share these things and I'm gonna say, what do you wanna do? Because I trust you and I wanna trust you. I wanna know that you're the perfect Father. That you've proven your love towards me and that you gave your son up on the cross. God, how could you love me more than anything else? And yes, it's hard for me to live that out, but you know what? That's what prayer is. The point of prayer is not to get stuff from God. It's to bring our heart into alignment with God. The goal of prayer shouldn't be to change God's mind, but it's allowing him to change our hearts. And when we pray this way, what we realize is that's what happens. We come to him and we let him change us because we trust him. We come and we say, God, here's my will, but your will be done. You see how it's transformative? Now, I will acknowledge this is hard to do. It's real easy to just put the end of the prayer. You know, God, do this if it's your will. It's hard to really pray this way. And just in it's a couple of closing thoughts, here's why. Here's the obstacles that keep us from praying this. The first is one that we've been talking about. This idea that when, you know, to say if we really confidently want to be able to pray this prayer, you know, we need two things. First of all, what we need is as we build on the foundation, we need to have confidence in God's character as our loving, all-knowing Father. That we believe that he is Father, that we believe that he is Father in heaven, that we believe that he is hallowed, that we believe that he's loved us, that we trust him. See, that's what we've been saying throughout the whole thing. You know, we're afraid to pray, God, your will be done, because we don't trust that his will is going to be good for us. We don't say, God, here's my desires, you take it, because, in fact, I remember one time, you know, when I was in college, I was dating somebody, and I said, okay, God, you know, you take this relationship's yours, and it's yours, and next thing you know, she broke up with me, and I was ticked off at God. I was like, God, I gave it to you, because you're supposed to give it back. You're supposed to say, boy, you've done a great job, let me bless it, and I was ticked off that God took it away from me. That's the way that we often are. You know, the thing is that I was mad because I thought that's what I needed. That's not what I needed. God had somebody better for me. I just couldn't see it at the time. We struggle with that because we really don't trust God. We feel like, God, I've got to tell you my will. I've got to tell you what's best for me. I've got to talk you into it. But if I really believed in the core of my being that God is a Father who's all-loving, all-knowing, all-powerful, that he has a plan for me that's the purest expression of what's best for me, is committed to me, you see, then it wouldn't be so hard to pray, God, your will be done. But there's another reason why this is hard. In fact, I think it's even the harder reason. You see, because not only do we need to believe that God is an all-loving Father who knows better than we do, we also have to accept the fact that we are a dependent and limited child. Not only does he know, but that we have to accept that we don't. This is hard. This is the harder thing for me to get. You see, it's ultimately building relationship with God, and we need to recognize that not only his greatness, but our limitness. You think about it this way. If you're a parent, you know, I can think of a four-year-old, and a four-year-old comes to the parent and their dad and saying, Dad, can I have this? And it, oftentimes we're saying, no, you can't have that, because a 30-something-year-old dad knows better than a four-year-old. And Dad, can I have the chainsaw? It looks like a lot of fun. No, you can't have a chainsaw. You know, I remember my one son, David. I mean, he loves all things World War II. And so when he was young, one time we just did something different. We took him to a gun show. And he saw all the, Dad, there's a bazooka. Can I have a bazooka? You know, can I bring that home? You know, no, that's not a good idea to give my son David a bazooka. That's not a, now he might melt in, you know, frustration, and he's sad. And every time that we deny a four-year-old's request, you know, they melt down, they cry, they throw a fit. Why? Because they think they know better than their father. Think about it this way. Do you know what worry is? Worry is us as spiritual four-year-olds thinking that we know how our life has to go, and we're fearing that God doesn't get it right. Do you know what bitterness is? It's us as spiritual four-year-olds thinking that we know how our life should go, and God hasn't gotten it right. And what Jesus Christ is inviting us to here is not only something that is rooted in a confidence in who God is, but it's also in a humility of who we are, of laying down this crushing burden of thinking that we've got to make all these decisions and we have it right. But it means living in humility to say that sometimes the things that we desire the most, God knows better than we do, and we're just spiritual four-year-olds. And not only do I have to get in touch with the fact that he is great, but I have to get in touch with my own limitations. And see, I can understand that with the 30-something-old and the four-year-old, the gap between me and God is a whole lot bigger than between it was when I was a parent and I had a four-year-old child. And if I believe that, what I'm going to learn is I'm going to learn, yes, it's hard and it's frustrating. And at times I'm going to scream and I'm going to be frustrated with God. Why doesn't he give me what I want? But you know what? He is a loving father, and I'm just an adolescent, and I don't know best. I think I do, but I don't. And I'm going to learn to pray, God, your will be done. I give you the right to take things. I give you the right to make different decisions that I want. I understand, even though I don't understand, I believe that as a loving dad, that at times you're going to keep me from things that I think I so much want, but that you know will destroy me. And I surrender to you. You see, it's all about relationship. It's all about relationship. Now, if you're here today and you don't have that relationship with God, he invites you to that relationship, not based on what you've done, but what Jesus has done, that he's died on the cross, that our sins would be forgiven. And for those of us that have, we've got to realize he invites us to prayer. Prayer is vital. It will change our lives. It will change. We start the year because we need as a church. It changes things. Miracles are done through prayer. We have a wall full of miracles in there that are changed by prayer. But most of all, it changes us. And it means as we come to God in prayer, it's not negotiating, transitional. You know, it's something that we come and come to him as he calls us to. He gives us an outline. If we don't know how to do it, he gives us the Lord's Prayer as guidelines to pray, our Father. Father who is in heaven, we praise your name. We want to make you central. And God, now we pray that your kingdom come. You be king in my life. And God, your will be done. It's not about me talking you into things. It's letting you change me. And Father, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And when we learn to pray that prayer, we will not only learn to know him better, but that we will learn to discover the blessings that he has for us in a depth that we couldn't now even imagine. I hope and pray that this week, through this series, especially through the next week and a half, that you seek God in prayer. Not only spending time in him, but coming to him the way that he teaches us to come. And I'm sure he will meet us in powerful ways as we do so.